Kumar Malavalli, professor of computer science there. It's Kumar Malavalli right there. And I like to bring in people that are not necessarily engineers or scientists, but talk about interesting things that are important that happen in the world. So I had my friend who runs Lockheed Skunk Works come in. I had General Khan from Pakistan come in. And now it's my great pleasure to introduce General Arjun Ray. General Ray had a very distinguished military career in India, and then instead of continuing that career and probably being the big boss of the whole Indian Army, because Kumar says he's such a really awesome guy, he decided to dedicate the rest of his career to education, which I think is an extremely admirable thing to do. He is in charge of the Indus schools in India, which are international baccalaureate institutions. I understand that they are among the very best in India in terms of quality. I would be delighted, thank you very much, if you send some of your students here. There's also a school that they've created entirely for underprivileged kids, I guess is the best way of saying it. So regardless of your ability to pay for a high quality education, you can come and be educated in this way, and that is a great way to really change the world and change the dynamic of how things happen. So not just the elite get quality education, but really deserving people. So General Ray, it's my pleasure to introduce you, and thank you so much for the long trip, and we look forward to a great talk.
Daryl, Mr. Kumar Malavalli, ladies and gentlemen, it's a privilege for me to be here amongst scientists and technicians and the technological elite of San Francisco. It may be interesting for you possibly to know as to why I'm here this morning. And I think the core message of my presentation I would like to get across to you right in the beginning. Warfare is as old as man. Peace is a modern invention. And I think it's also important for us to understand that while maximum progress has been made in science and technology, least progress has been made in the development of leadership. And therefore, as engineers, irrespective of what category of engineering we are involved in, at the end of the day, scientists and engineers must bring in peace, prosperity, and happiness in society. Otherwise, it makes a nonsense of whatever academic credentials or qualifications we may have. And this is why I'm talking to an engineering audience, if I may be permitted to use that phrase. It may interest you to know, ladies and gentlemen, that I did a study of 100 Nobel laureates. The last 100 Nobel laureates in peace, 96% of them are from liberal arts, and only 4 from a science background. The 100 Times cover, Man of the Year, 93% are from liberal arts, and only 7% are from a background of science and technology. You can draw your own conclusions. I think, therefore, it is very, very important for the scientific community to understand that science has got a bigger role to play. Science must, at the end of the day, bring peace, prosperity, and happiness in society. Otherwise, that science is of no use. So, well, there's been tremendous progress in science and technology in the last 70 to 75 years. Today, the world faces the biggest crisis. It's not oil, it's not money. The biggest crisis is the crisis of leadership. Climate collapse is a failure of leadership. Wall Street crash of 2008 is a failure of leadership. Poverty, illiteracy are failures of leadership. And the leadership is a failure of education. And therefore, I feel, as a personal view of mine, that people from the engineering community need to understand peace, possibly more than others. And members of the engineering community need to consider themselves as leaders and not as scientists in white coats and laboratories with rats and monkeys over there, but as leaders of society, leaders who are harbingers and messengers of and prophets of peace and prosperity. So this is why, and possibly during discussion time, we could talk about why there is a leadership crisis. Why there is a leadership crisis. I mean, that itself is a very big subject. And I think from an engineering point of view, it's important for us to get this message across that engineers, of irrespective of their color and category, need to understand peace and to be leaders of peace. Now, with that as a background, I will talk to you today with my favorite theme that peace is everybody's business. It's not only the responsibility of President Obama or kings and presidents and prime ministers of countries, it is every citizen's responsibility. In June, early June 2000, I was promoted to a lieutenant general and given the command of 14 Corps, that is the northernmost portion of India, which is called Ladakh. And at that point of time, insurgency was spilling into from the valley into my particular area. Now, to give you an idea what Ladakh looks like, on the east, you got Tibet, which is under China now. On the west, you got Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. And in the middle, you got the area which is more fawn and brown in color, Ladakh, which would be possibly as big as one of your large states in USA. This is the highest battleground in the world, up to 22,000 feet, and that's the famous Siachen Glacier, where a large body of my troops were positioned. This gives you an idea that helicopters at this height can only carry 20% of their payload. So this elevated helicopter, if it carries 100 kilos, can only carry 20 kilos. That's all, period, because of the high altitude factor. This is the Thikse Monastery. 50% of the people here are Muslims, and 50% are Buddhists, devout Buddhists. This is the future Buddha, as the Buddhists worship. And this is the famous Indus River, and India takes its name after the Indus River, and our schools also take the name after the Indus River, which starts in China, flows to Ladakh, into Pakistan, and then into the Arabian Sea. Now, just to make it a little more interesting, it is believed that these four villages in Ladakh have the remnants of the true Aryans of modern civilization. And till about 20, 25 years back, a large number of Germans used to go there for obvious reasons. And you can see that they've got very distinctive Aryan features. They are the only surviving Aryan colonies in the world today. This is the Pangong So Lake, half in China, half with India. It is at 14,500 feet. It is even more beautiful than what you see in the photograph. It's a saltwater lake, and it's absolutely meditative, and that zen-like feeling which you get over there. Now, the emerging scenario when I took over, as I said to you, that there was mass alienation. I was more concerned and bothered about mass alienation. And as leaders, I think we need to look at alienation in a big way. I was not so concerned about the caches of arms and weapons being found, or shootouts, or lamas being killed and political leaders being killed. and terrorists coming over, I was more bothered about alienation. Because the opposite of life is not death, it is indifference. The opposite of peace is not struggle, it is indifference. When a society becomes indifferent, they couldn't care a damn what you do to them. That, I think, is a flashpoint for leaders to look at very seriously. And I think this was the sort of red light as far as I was concerned, and I had to take a quick decision on what I was to do. To use the gun, as everybody had done in the past and failed. We'd been to war with Pakistan 4 times with no solution at the end of the tunnel. And my history told me, and for I am a good student of history. I learned from history, and the biggest lesson history teaches us is that we never learn from history. History tells us that political power does not come out of the barrel of a gun. It never did. And in the 21st century, political power cannot be based on brute military power or guns. And my study of history told me that the oxygen for survival for any form of insurgency, of any form of alienation, is you must have the people on your side. They are the oxygen. If the people are on your side, if popular support is with you, if we are not seen to be at war with our own people, which we were, then I think there is hope for peace and there is hope for conflict resolution. So I decided to keep my guns aside, keep the powder dry. They were always there with me as what they call is a threat in being. That power is always there. And I took the decision. It was a solitary decision. Nobody supported me at that point of time. My wife, my aides, my generals, my colonels, my soldiers, my bosses, the administration. And that's when I learned one of the biggest lessons of leadership. You don't need 99% to start a revolution. You need 1%. And as leaders, you have to be prepared to walk down the road alone, armed with nothing but your vision. Therefore, in transformational change, when you want to bring about transformation in an organization, in society, in a company, anywhere, you have to be prepared to walk it alone. As Mandela said, to break away from the pack. You have to break away from the pack at some point of time. And I think that is the biggest lesson, the first biggest lesson which I learned. You may be wondering as to why it's very fashionable for generals to talk of peace when they have retired. I practiced peace when I was in military command of the most powerful military machine. I had helicopters around my, 62 helicopters with me. They were like in my garage, the helicopters were parked. I could have all about 70,000 troops at my command. I had everything available with me. I had fighter aircraft, I had everything available with me. I decided not to use it. And I did it while I was in power. It's very easy to talk about it when you are out of uniform. I brought peace until today, 14 years down the line, not a shot has been fired, not a bomb has been gone up. Muslims and Buddhists live in peace and harmony. So the whole exercise, this mass socio-political campaign we launched in Ladakh, was to win back people, alienated people, into the main fold, into the mainstream. That was the aim of the whole exercise. Now, there were 6 strategies, and you can apply these strategies in your personal life, in your companies, in your departments, wherever you work. The first strategy or hypothesis is that in a flat, messy, and interconnected world, the notion that governments alone are responsible for governance is a lot of baloney. It's an outdated idea. It was okay when societies were monolithic. It was, command and control style of functioning. The industrial age model over there. But I believe that governance is a collective responsibility. Every citizen is responsible for governance. Especially so in remote and sensitive areas where the reach of the government is limited for a variety of reasons. It is absolutely important for us to understand that peace is everybody's responsibility. I think this is a point I would like to drive home. And having said that, in this whole game that is being played, there is one dominant player. And this was a bone of contention between me and the civil administration. A lot of people said that I was a megalomaniac. A lot of people said that, I was pursuing higher ambition. But the fact of the matter is that there has to be one dominant player. Everybody else piggybacks on that dominant player. And the dominant player in Ladakh was the army. We had the capacity, we had the leadership, we had the resources, we had the equipment, we had the funds, we had the will, we had the patriotism, we had the fervor to put it together. And therefore, till the very end, the civil administration never understood that they had to piggyback us if peace was to be everybody's business. The second strategy, when I think as the educated elite of the 21st century, we need to understand that national security is no longer the sum total of your economic power and military power. Therefore, if the United States of America is talking of national security, it has got to look beyond its economic prowess and its military power. That's again the industrial age, an era gone by concept over there. Because there is a major tectonic power shift that has taken place. And the shift is from security of the state to security of the people. Today, security of the people is more important than security of the state. If the people of a state are insecure, the state will collapse. So this is the tectonic shift which I see. And a corollary to this is that it is very commonly believed by all experts. And let me tell you, when we talk about experts in leadership, there are 89,000 books which have been written on leadership. There are over 650 definitions of leadership. And in 2012-2013, $650 billion was spent on leadership training. And despite that, we have a leadership crisis. 98% of the books on leadership are written by people who are not leaders. It's like I writing a book on graphics and animation and data storage, and you being asked to teach that book in class, prescribed syllabus. 98% of them are not written by leaders. The best-selling books on leadership, your best-selling authors are not leaders. They are academicians, they are management consultants, some are clergymen, some are woodcutters, some are butchers, some have made it big. 98% books which you all read on leadership are written by people who are not leaders. So I think that is something which, and the common thinking continues to be, despite all the evidence staring us in the face, is that if governance is in place and development takes place, everything is okay. Well, let me tell you, Hitler had governance. Pol Pot had governance. A large number of despots and military rulers in society and history have had governance, good governance, effective governance, development, give people hospitals, give them roads, give them aircraft, give them communications, and you can win people over. It's like when a marriage is over. And you say, darling, I'll give you all the diamonds in the world. I'll give you all the BMWs and the Audis and the Mercs in the world. Come back to me. She will take all the diamonds and give you a big kick and walk away. You cannot buy people security by sheer good governance and sheer development. To me, human security is the centrality of peace and security. If you want peace, your people have to be happy. You want peace in the family, your people must be happy. In society, people must be happy. In a nation, people have to be happy. Just having good communication, good roads, good colleges, good universities by themselves will not make people happy, will not give you security. So the answer to all our problems in the world, wherever we face insurgencies and these problems, was give them good roads, give them hospitals, give them jobs. And nothing happened. Humans' insecurity is the root cause for social inequality. It is the root cause for religious fundamentalism. It is the root cause for conflict. It is the root cause for alienation. People can have everything and yet be unhappy. People can have little of everything and be happy. And therefore, the shift that I talked about, the shift from security of the state, your borders, everything are secure, is not enough. Your people have to be secure. And I think that is the central message. So far, all history has been looking outside the window. Now we have to turn the light inwards onto ourselves. Peace is born inside your home, not outside in the suburb. So this was the second strategy which we practiced and succeeded. I don't know, I suppose many men in uniform would not agree with me. Despite the new world order, which is you're all aware of, our thinking is still Clausewitzian. It is still World War I and World War II thinking. Fight, destroy, and win. Fight, destroy, capture, and win. That is the end all and be all of all military doctrine. So whether it's in the Middle East, whether it's in Africa, whether it's in India, Pakistan, wherever it is, our military thinking continues to be Clausewitzian. Because in an interconnected world, war as an instrument of national policy is no longer valid. We're all interconnected. If something happens to me, you all sink with me. You can't afford it. So because of this interconnectivity, economic interconnectivity of the world, that is, war as an instrument of national policy is an outdated idea. Therefore, to me, what I said to the soldiers particularly, and this was the most difficult part to convey to our soldiers to make them understand that the primary role of the armed forces is no longer to win war. It is to prevent war. Armed forces prevent war through diplomacy, through military doctrine, through superior technology, that's where all you guys come in. Through information dominance, you have so much of information dominance on the adversary that you can checkmate him at any given point of time. And of course, your people have to be on your side. This is why the Western powers could not intervene in Syria. And this is why the Western powers are unable to intervene in Nigeria, where so much is happening right now. you got to have world consensus. You got to have the people of your own country have to support you before you go to war any longer now. And this is very, very important for us to understand. And as the role of the military has changed, I think the role of the soldier has changed. Soldier, sailor, airman has changed. You are a citizen first and then a soldier. You are a citizen first and then a professor or a doctor or an entrepreneur or a this or a that, whatever. You are a citizen first. And I think if this is the psyche of modern man and modern woman, it's important to understand, and this is again a shift in power that has taken place. The armed forces belong to the state. In today's world, the armed forces belong to the people. The commitment of the armed forces will remain till the commitment of the people is there. The day the commitment of the people fails, the armed forces will fail. Vietnam is a classic example. The armed forces belong to the people. They don't belong to the government. And their survival, their capability to perform depends on the will and determination and the support they get from the people. This was a very difficult aspect for a man who is trained right from the beginning like a Rottweiler to kill. A soldier is taught that your aim is to kill. One shot, one dead man. Now you are asking me to make peace, to make love to the people over there. A soldier finds it extremely difficult. And I suppose out of 70,000 troops I had, possibly 10% believed in what I said. And as I said earlier, you don't need 10% or 20% to succeed. You need 1% people, that's all. You need 1% to start a revolution. One of the great shibboleths continues today. This whole cliche of winning the hearts and mind battle, it's a shibboleth. You cannot win the minds of people till you win the hearts of the people. Winning the heart is winning the trust of the people. It's only when you win the trust of the people that you can win the minds of the people. So far, all governments and all countries and all armed forces, they believe that hearts and the minds could be won together. I said to my command and to my people that don't worry about the mind. Win the trust of the people. And we went to such extent that I am possibly the only non-Muslim, maybe in recorded history in recent times, who addressed the Friday prayers of mass congregations of Muslims, a Hindu addressing them, and they allowed me to do it. That was the trust they had in me, that I would do nothing ever to let them down on any account. And therefore, it's important for us to understand that winning the heart has to precede winning the mind. Whether it's in human relationships, in state relationships, if you don't trust your neighbor, however good the offer may be, you won't take it. All business is done on trust. Mr. Kumar Mallavalli, one of the great entrepreneurs of the Silicon Valley, he'll attest to that business is based on trust. What is this due diligence that we do? It's all based on trust, that I trust you. I'll put money on you, on your plan, on your scheme. So we never discussed politics and religion. And that was my military. In all military messages, we don't discuss three things. We don't discuss politics, we don't discuss religion, and we don't discuss women. All three are emotive. and they lead to conflict. We don't discuss them in the officer's mess. So we never discuss this. And our aim was only to address the genuine concerns of the people. We became a one-window contact for the people. The people had any problem, come to the one-window contact. We will contact the administration, we will contact the Delhi or wherever it is, and we'll get the job done. You come to us. We'll sort it out. And of course, it took a lot of courage to correct the perceived and the actual wrongs of the past. We had also done bad things, the naughty things in the past. And many of them were perceived, real, imaginary, but then there is this great word sorry in every language, and the promise that what has happened, I'm extremely sorry about it. I can assure you it will never happen again, and I'll make amends. I think a collective view on this particular aspect assuaged the people, and we were able to win their hearts and to defeat insurgency completely, stop dead in its tracks. They couldn't do it. In fact, a lot of propaganda which came out from Pakistan across the border said that your General Ray will be going very soon. So what is going to happen to you guys? Well, General Ray left 16 years, left in 2002, 31st of March, and now we are into 2014. Peace is held. Some of the structures which we had set up have been dismantled by people who came after me. But the spirit is there. The spirit of peace and harmony between the communities and within the national fold continues to be there. The fifth strategy, which is extremely important, is women's empowerment. If you want peace, empower the women. Advice to husbands, advice to boyfriends, advice to partners, advice to community leaders, advice to national leaders. If you want peace, you want to deal with social inequalities, empower the women. Because women genetically abhor violence of all kinds. Because women, at the end of the day, they bear the brunt of violence. An average woman in Ladakh has about 8 to 9 kids. And imagine a husband getting killed or locked up by us in the jails, in the prison houses over there. What's going to happen to her? Where does she go? Who's going to feed these 8 kids? She realizes the importance of peace. She abhors violence. Therefore, if you want, the desire of peace is more in a woman than in a man. Man is more aggressive. And therefore, my buzzword to everybody was that human security will be endangered, if not engendered. This was the talisman. This was the other magic potion or formula, which was very successful in conflict prevention. Human security will be endangered, if not engendered. We empowered women through primary education. We set up large number of women's empowerment centers, adult education centers for illiterate women between 18 and 35, orphanages, large number of orphans over there. We set up orphanages. We set up homes for widows. We set up hostels for women who wanted to go and work outside. And we set up resource centers for children who were physically and mentally challenged. And because of the inbreeding in Ladakh, there's a lot of inbreeding in Ladakh, and children being born in later menopause periods over there, nearly 8 to 9% children are physically challenged or mentally challenged over there. Something had to be done about that. So a lot of work on this was done, and we had the support of the women with us. Because women ensured that her children would not take up arms or take up insurgency. Women were there to educate the people in the home not to do it. And therefore, this was a very, very successful strategy over there. Ladies and gentlemen, and this is what I'm going to talk at the Thai conference also, my theme is going to be that future competition in the 21st century is not going to be between competing economic systems, between competing political ideologies, it's going to be between competing education systems, period. The individual, the family, the society that has a superior education system is going to be a superpower, and that is why your country is a superpower, because of the knowledge capital that it has. It is education, education, and education that is going to ensure peace and stability, but the right type of education. Let me give you an example. We set up from somewhere, you know, the skies opened up, and Nicholas Negroponte, you all heard of him? The guru of IT, MIT, Nicholas Negroponte, the inventor, the guru of information technology. He, his wife, and the team from MIT, they suddenly heard about my work and they descended there. They said, "General, we want to help you." Then God was on my side, our education minister, IT minister, Mr. Pramod Mahajan. Somebody said to me that I should go and approach him. So a meeting was fixed up in Delhi. I flew down to Delhi to meet him at 9 o'clock in the morning. And his secretary told me that he's just leaving for the airport. You know, one of those things, politicians, last minute changes over there. I said, "Listen, I have to meet him. I have to meet him for 5 minutes. I'm a general of the army. He can't say no to me. He has to listen to me." So he went and told the minister. So minister said, "All right." So the minister was in his bedroom. He was changing. He was putting on his clothes. And General Arjun Ray had his laptop over here with his presentation. And in 3 minutes, I had to convince him that he better give me 16 VSAT terminals. In 2000, this was a novelty. Internet had hardly just come into India. So at a mind-boggling figure, he looked at me and said, "All right, General, given. The information technology department will give you 17 VSAT terminals and we'll have them flown in by aircraft and set up over there." So we set up a large number of schools. You saw those big mountain ridges over there, right up to last. I think high school was 17, 18,000 feet. Where oxygen is 20% less than what you are breathing right now. And 7 months of the year, Ladakh is cut off. We are all air maintained. You want eggs, you want bread, you want tomatoes, it all has to be flown in. It was cut off by snow. The whole armed forces, all the armed forces there, the air force over there, and all the civilians, we're all air maintained. So this was a great boon. So in this school, I said, we're going to teach the children Islam and we're going to teach the children Buddhism. Everybody was horrified. My general said to me that this was disaster. I said to them, I said, "Listen, all religions teach spirituality. All religions teach values. All religions teach discipline. You tell me which religion says that you should go and murder somebody, or to go and steal your TV set, or rape and kill and murder. No religion says that." I said, "I'd rather have him teach these things in my presence than for him to go somewhere else and teach him something else." So I made the teaching of Islam and Buddhism compulsory in all these schools. So this is what I mean by the right education. Education by itself is meaningless. You can be a triple PhD and be illiterate, as far as I'm concerned. Because there's a difference between an academic institution and an educational institution. An academic institution prepares you for a job, for money. An educational institution prepares you for life. To be a good human being, to be an engaged and responsible citizen, to have a person with the competencies to survive and flourish in the 21st century. And above all, as I said, to be a good human being. So education qualifications, academic qualifications by themselves are meaningless, absolutely meaningless. My question to all these guys who come with these big qualifications is, what else are you capable of? What else are you capable of? Oh, I know you're triple, double PhD. I know you've invented this, but what are you capable of? How are you going to use it? What's its relevance? So ladies and gentlemen, the whole campaign that we launched was based on my unflinching and firm belief in the innate goodness of man. I still today believe that man is innately good. All good people can become evil. You change the environment, you change the circumstances, good men can become evil. At the same time, evil men can also become good if you change the environment. And therefore, this was important for me. And as a young student, I read the preamble of the United Nations, which says that since wars arise in the minds of men, it is in the minds of men that the defenses of peace must be constructed. And this whole game of leadership for peace, for conflict prevention, is about constructing these defenses to ensure peace. And as engineers, as great technologists, as those who are privileged to be here in this part of the world, which is actually the knowledge capital of the world, my message to you is this, that irrespective of our color, creed, whatever we are doing, at the end of the day, if we cannot bring peace, prosperity, social equity, eliminate poverty, and bring some form of happiness to the people over there, life has not been worthwhile. And like you have GDP, and like you have GNP, you also need gross national happiness, GNH. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for having given me a patient listening over here. And I'm just putting this over here for whatever it is worth, in case anybody is interested. I think the power of vision is very, very important for us to understand. It's critical. It is the oxygen, is the O2 of any change you want to bring about. Imperfect solutions in time are better than perfect solutions that come late. You must, in today's world, which is a crisis-driven world, where chaos theory, complexity at its height, you have to start running as you hit the ground. You have to start kicking the ball first and then working out your strategy later on. You cannot go in a sequential manner. And therefore, imperfect solutions that are put in time are better than perfect solutions which are late. The biggest enemy is within us. The biggest opposition to our program in Ladakh came from within the organization. But then, human psychology and history was on our side. As I said, 99% people will follow that 1%. You need only 1% to start a movement. Are you part of that 1% or are you part of 99%? This is something which you got to think over when you go home today after my talk. Are you part of 1% or are you part of 99%? And in today's day and age, command control type of leadership is out of the question. It has to be mission control. Give people the why of what you are doing, the dividends that will come if we succeed. You give them certain terms of references. You give them broad goals. You give them broad resources and leave the execution to them. Don't micromanage them. So these are some of the important things from a transformational leadership point of view. And these are all, each subject is an MPhil or a PhD by itself. So I have given you leadership perspective from a practitioner, one who succeeded. And the third very big lesson which emerged from this, and I remember the day Mr. Kumar Mallavalli called me up from here. He had seen me on some interview being done by CNN, and he said whether I'd like to join him in this particular thing over here. I think what opened my eyes, and I realized that my biggest spurt in life came at the age of 55. And I don't want this should happen to anybody else. I'd been to war in 65, I'd been to war In 71, I'd been fighting the Tamil Tigers in Sri Lanka. It made no difference on me. I was like anybody else. And I realized that I did not know how to reflect. Ladies and gentlemen, if we do not reflect on our experiences, you might as well not have that experience. If you want to read a great book, like the books lying in your office, interestingly, he's reading Hemingway. Great, full points to you, sir. If you read a good book and you don't reflect on it, please don't read it. You meet an interesting person and you don't reflect on what she has said or he has said, don't meet that person. And because I could not reflect, and by default I started to reflect, I realized that life must have a higher purpose. We are not human beings having a spiritual experience. We are spiritual beings having a human experience. And I think we need to understand that life has to have a higher goal, much beyond fame, power, position, money and wealth. Otherwise, it makes, as I said, a nonsense of whatever God you believe in, or whatever religion you believe in. And the beauty about this is that spirituality does not come out of religion. Religion comes out of spirituality. You can be an atheist and be spiritual. I can be a pandit or a clergyman or a maulvi, pray 5 times a day, go to church every day, and yet not be spiritual. So spirituality is the central core. And when we seek spirituality, what we are actually understanding is that we are seeking a higher goal in life. And it makes no difference what goal you perceive, as long as there is a goal. The tragedy of life does not lie in not reaching your goal. The tragedy of life lies in not having a goal to reach. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I don't know if it makes sense or confuse you or any questions you'd like to ask, provided they're difficult questions. Please don't ask me simple questions. Please ask me difficult questions. And I should be able to say, I do not know. Because when a man says, I do not know, that is the beginning of knowledge.
So I'm going to take Bo's prerogative and ask the first question.
Yes, sir.
So I agree with you wholeheartedly that probably the most powerful thing we can do is empowering and educating the women, especially the third world. So what do we do about Boko Haram?
Actually, it is a very political issue, and I don't have the full facts before me, except to say that whatever has happened is tragic. And it is very, very tragic. And I would say that the character of a country, of a nation, depends on the way that nation treats its women. Unfortunately, because of our political interests, what we describe as national interest, whether it be oil or it be for politics, we tend to overlook it, But from my personal point of view, I think it is tragic what has happened over there, absolutely tragic over there. Any society or religion or country which does not respect its women, as far as I'm concerned, is out. I mean, I have no time for them. That's all that I can say. I have no political answers because it's all a messy subject. It depends which side of the fence you are and what you are looking at. Absolutely, I agree. Yeah, any country which culturally or religiously discourages the education of its women over there, especially in today's day and age, is unthinkable as far as I'm concerned. I mean, I would not respect them. Yes, ma'am.
Bull in the back of the room, the back worries about the nuclear war, and I'm of course talking about the Indo-Pakistan conflict, because I assume that I'm not sure, but the insurgency in Ladakh was probably, and in fact I'd like clarification on that, who were the insurgents? Were they Pakistani-inspired insurgents, or was it Chinese? But more, I think I'm asking the question of what would you propose in today's world? And there's a professor, Marty Hellman, who delivered a lecture on campus about the worries about this. My good friend and former professor, Marcia Sen, spent sleepless nights worrying about this. What do you propose as a general, ex-general from the army, what do you propose that India do, because that's what we have control over, India do to diffuse this tension that exists between Pakistan and India?
I think there was an American lady who visited one of the most holy sites, Haridwar, in India. And she was a writer. And she wanted to meet a great Swami, Swami Chinmayananda, over there. She wanted an audience with him. And Swamiji had no time for her. So her friends got in touch with the local military commander, who was a brigadier, and said to him that since you are the station commander here and you know Swamiji, can you use your influence to get an audience for her? So the brigadier prevailed upon Swamiji. He was a great, Professor Shivram Mallavalli will tell you what a great, one of the great spiritual leaders our country has produced. So when this American lady went in over there, she said, Swamiji, I have just one question. What is God? He said, he got very worked up. He shouldn't have got worked up. He says, madam, for 75 years, I have been trying to find the answer. You expect me to answer in 5 minutes what is God? I'm sorry you come to the wrong person. But I think the main issue now, the way I look at it, from a conflict resolution point of view, you see, I cannot undo what has happened in the past. Who's right, who's wrong? It's such a state of confusion that everybody believes that he is right and she believes that she is right. I think we have to have our own people on our own side. That is the main thing. We cannot be at war with our own people. And if our own people believe that they are part of us and our own people believe that they are with us over there, then no power, however strong it may be, can do anything to us. And I think we need to focus, societies need to focus more on their people and then to be worried about people of other societies over there. And I think this is the whole game that we played, not the game, but the strategy we played was win the hearts and minds of your own people first. And that is most important. We had four wars with Pakistan, there has been no solution. They also know there is no solution. We also should know there is no solution. So if war is not the solution, then what is the solution? The solution is that we have to have, both countries need to work on their own people. And that is where the leadership comes in. And that is where leadership has failed. Leadership has failed because leadership is always looking outside the window. Leaders must look inside the window and look at their own flock. Keep your flock together, ma'am, and you won't have any problem. That is the short answer. Yes, ma'am. You're talking about privacy laws.
Yes.
I agree with you. Although it is inevitable, but I agree with you that privacy laws must be protected, and it is for the people of a country, the voice of a country. I mean, if you have a strong voice, you will be able to prevent it. If you don't have a strong voice, you won't be able to prevent it. I completely share your concerns that there is a line has got to be drawn, what is private and what is official. I absolutely agree with you. I couldn't agree more with you. And I think it will happen that way. The gentleman in the audience are very quiet. Daryl, any problem? The gentleman in the audience are very quiet. Yeah. This young lady in the front, yeah.
knowledge rich and the knowledge poor. And those who can afford the education to be knowledge rich versus those who can't afford.
And also adding on to what you have said, it is not only investing in your knowledge, you also have to invest that knowledge in other people.
Yes.
It's payback time.
Yes.
So payback time is not just, you see, so far the pattern of investments in all our families has been gold, trousseau, property, stocks and shares. This is how we, isn't it? We invest. You now must invest in knowledge. Not only your knowledge, but you, the knowledge which you acquire, that knowledge is payback time. You must pass that knowledge on to other people. That is the problem.
Where do you think the crux of this problem lies? Who do you think will drive that? Is it the government?
You. In today's society, you are more powerful than the government. That is what you got to understand. And governance is not the sole responsibility of the government. It is your responsibility as well. You are equally responsible for it. You cannot be a hapless citizen and just sit over there and say there's nothing I can do. Everything that you can do. So in this new age of empowerment, there's more power in your hands now than what you had before. And I think governments do realize that, whether it's through elections or whether it is through other methodologies. But I think you have to believe in it first before you start looking at government. I think we need to do a lot of self-correction ourselves before we sort of... My only message to you is turn the light inwards, flash the light inwards, and when that, if all of us can do it, 1% can do it. You don't need 99%. If 1% of society can do it, governments will listen to us. But I have not seen any protests over here in the country on what you are saying. You are all gladly accepting it. Where are they? Where are those big Occupy movements on privacy laws? Where are they happening? They're not happening. That means you are accepting it. Yeah, gentlemen at the back, anything we'd like to say? All very quiet. Again, lady's hand going up. Yeah, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
I'd love to hear your perspective on the recent election in India.
Sorry?
I'd love to hear your perspective on the recent election.
Well, the outcome is on the 16th or 17th. We'll all come to know what happens. But from a leadership perspective, without taking any names, I would say that any country today, a democratic country, democracy as we all understand, we don't need to define, we all understand democracy, that leader has to be secular. And you know what secular means. 1% dissatisfaction in a country can run you aground. Because of what happened at the Golden Temple many years back, just a handful of Sikhs who were upset with what had happened. And my personal view is that to kill a rat, you don't have to pull a house down. There was a better way of doing it. The insurgency lasted for 10 years and led to the assassination of our Prime Minister. And in a country like ours, which has got 16% Muslims, 3% Catholics, and another 3-4% of other religions, virtually 25%, you have to be secular. Number two, the task of a leader is to bring sides together. What do mummies and daddies do? Do you take sides of your children? You bring children together, isn't it? So in whom mummy and daddy brings the children together. So leaders must bring people of opposite viewpoints together at the table. You can't afford to have authoritarian views on certain issues and say, no, this is, there's only one way to skin a cat. Remember, there are many ways to skin a cat. Therefore, in today's complex times, chaotic times over there, you need leaders who are secular, who are perceived to be secular. It's not only to say that you are secular, but people must perceive you to be secular and to see you as a person who brings sides together. Life is always in the gray zone. Life is never black and white. We all, good leaders, all know how to operate in the gray zone, because life is all about gray. And if you apply this yardstick, you can select your leader of whichever country you want to select. Yes, there was a, yeah, yes, sir.
So you mentioned that half of the people of Ladakh were Buddhists and half were Muslim.
Affirmative.
What was the mix of the 70,000 troops that you had?
70,000 troops would be 97%, 98% Hindus and 3% other religions, Christians. And say if I include Christians also, there are quite a few Christians, about 97%, 96%.
And then the follow-on question, you said 10% of them were following your example and approach.
Who believed me?
Right. Were they, since it was 97% Hindu, it was primarily then those who were following, or were the 3%?
No, but we did not do any poll or survey over there, but I think the I would say the overall, the civil administration was not with me, except certain leading politicians who were friends from my college days. And it's easier to deal with a politician than with a bureaucrat, let me tell you that. Yeah, politicians are not a problem, bureaucrats are the civil servants are a problem. They said, this is not your job, it is our job. And the military said, this is not our job, it is their job. So, I think another important lesson which I learned for myself and from a leadership perspective is that as a leader, you cannot allow the situation to drift under you. You have to act. I had to act. The choice was pick up the gun and fail in whatever has happened in the past, or to do something new and hope it succeeds. And that is, I think, a choice which I had to exercise very quickly. And as I said, as events turned out, I was proved right. It worked. It has worked in history. Soldiers said, this is not our job. These, whatever resources we have, this is our resources. I said, no, these are national assets. These are not your resources. If a woman comes to my house and she says, I'm a widow, I've been thrown out of my house, what do I say to her? Get away. Go away. Go to somebody else. Go to the administration. Or as a citizen, what do I do? You tell me, sir. If you are a citizen first and a woman comes to you in distress, what do you do? Do you help her or do you say, go away? What do you do?
Of course
you know. Yes. So I told the soldiers, you are citizens first and not soldiers. So discharge your citizens' duties first. But for people who have been brought up right from the beginning to kill, and I used to say to them that the aim of war is never to kill, although some killing may be necessary. You know, the baddies have to be taken out, but the aim of war is never to kill. So it was, I also enjoyed the authority and the position. I was a very senior military commander there, and because of my maverick past, I suppose many people didn't want to lock horns with me. I say, jolly well, we'll do it. I'm the boss over here. You will share your resources. And it worked. I said, the option is, we go to war and you go back in a body bag. Your kids are going to be orphaned. Your wife is going to be without a job. Or follow my strategy, live happily in peace and secure the border. So security of the borders is not physical security. It is the security of the people you are responsible for. That was... It's not easy for people to understand who've been brought up, Rottweilers, locked up in a cage and suddenly opened one day and thrown raw meat and they go for it. That's what soldiers are. They're preparing for that particular day. Therefore, convincing them was not easy. But I didn't worry about that. As I said, you only need 1% people on your side. Yes, ma'am. I think following on from what I have just spoken to you, we have created an equal opportunity school alongside our flagship school in Bangalore, and this has largely been due to Mr. Kumar Mallavalli's empathetic approach to life about his payback time And without his support, this would never have been possible. And the concept of equal opportunity is different to normal schooling. Anybody can start a school. You have poor kids in a downtown area, you give them some teachers, you give them some schools, you give them some education. But an equal opportunity is that life is about giving equal opportunity to people. It's incorrect to say that all men are born equal, some are more equal than others. Animal Farm. And I think the whole concept is based on the philosophy that if you give underprivileged children the same facilities, the same privileges, the same opportunities that privileged children have, they will do well. Enough, Thomas Friedman writes to say that when he was a small child, his mother used to say, "Don't leave anything on your plate. They are starving millions of Chinese and Indians." He says, now I tell my children, study hard. The Chinese and the Indians are taking your jobs away. So I think the opportunities which you get, and I have a small little video on this also, to some of those of you who are coming, who are meeting me on the 15th, children who could not speak a word of English, in 3 years' time, speak better grammatical English than most children in India and advanced European countries. That fire and motivation in them, it is intrinsic motivation. So when you give those opportunities, there's a Muslim girl who comes from a very traditional background, burqas and everything like that. She's going into the national golf circuit and she's in grade 9. The other three Muslim kids who are on horseback, they are racing for a foreign company. They are jockeys. They are already becoming jockeys. So it's the opportunity in life which is most important. So this is an equal opportunity school, and it has been extremely, extremely successful. It has been so far. And I'm sure this is the way ahead, that governments and states need to have not schools, but when I said the right type of schools, it is the schools which give them the same opportunities. These poor kids, now to give you an idea, Harker School over here, to be in Harker School, you heard of Harker School here in San Francisco? The fees is $30,000 per year. Well, these kids, those who pay, most of them don't pay, they pay this, for the same education, $115 a year. That is the magic. Madam, that is the magic. That for $115 a year, you are giving the education which others are giving at $30,000 a year. That is magic. That is equal opportunity. Have I answered your question?
Yes. Are
they going up to K-12. So let's see if we are trying to see how we can mobilize people in over here to sort of fund them for higher education over here, maybe in the States over here. Let's see how it works out there, but we'll try, keep on trying. Yes, sir.
Do you, in your schools, explicitly teach conflict?
Before I forget, let me give you another very interesting statistic. United States spends 6 times more on prison inmates than on education. State of California has got the highest number of inmates in the world. The state of California spends $9,000 for the education of one student and $47,000 to maintain one inmate. Please draw your own conclusions. How do you explain this? If you spend that same amount of money on the education of these guys who are inside the prison, you'd possibly have less of a responsibility of crime on the streets over there. So it's a question of priorities, how you look at society. Yes, sir.
So I've very few places, maybe Denmark, some place I've seen that all the way from primary education up to college,
You want a philosophical answer or a matter-of-fact answer?
More practical, but both aspects, I think.
There is a difference in knowing about and being. To know about the Bible and the Quran, and to know about the Gita, is to be inquisitive. To be the Bible, to be the Gita, and to be the Quran is transformational. To know about is just to be inquisitive. I think this is the important aspect, that in schools, values cannot be taught in the classrooms, because values are experiential. They are transformational. Unless and until the children of a school practice what I would call servant leadership, is to serve the community in its genuine sense and not to earn brownie points to get admissions in your beautiful engineering college over here, those values cannot be learnt. Books do not teach you values. They can supplement, they can complement it, but it has to be done on the ground. Yes, sir. You, ma'am, you raised your hand.
Yes, I did. One of the things that you said, thank you, was that human security, or the lack thereof, is the root cause of social inequality. Now, I may be biased as an economist, and I know that is not a sufficient condition, but don't you think that economic inequality, the lack of resources available to a significant portion of the population, is responsible lack of human security? I'm sort of putting it in the reverse, rather than that, in fact, a lot of problems.
Take a country like Bhutan. It's a landlocked country between China and India. Bhutan has the growth, the national rate of happiness is higher than United States of America. Yeah. Their GDP is nowhere near you. Their GDP is 133 in the ranking order over there. So I don't think, I can give you examples of so many states in India, like Bihar, like Orissa, like Madhya Pradesh, like Rajasthan, which are backward states, but there is no insurgency there. I'm not saying that there should not be economic growth, but economic growth per se does not bring happiness and security to people. People must feel secure over there. This social inequalities that you have is because of economic inequalities. And I think this is an area, I would say development economics is something which Amartya Sen has been, he's one of the great leaders in this particular aspect. And maybe, if I pronounce his name correctly, Daniel Kahneman, is that the correct pronunciation? He is from, I think, Stanford or Columbia. He's a great psychologist, and he's got the Nobel Prize in economics. It's called happiness economics. If you look at some of our kids in poor areas, they're very happy kids there actually. We who have so much of everything, we are possibly are not equally happy. So money itself does not bring happiness. My mother said to me, the best things in life are free. Agreed.
Conflict or the sort of that's I was trying to.
Yes, you're right. You're absolutely right. I agree with you. And one of the issues I think United States has got to look at is that if you look at all the international rankings which are done for in schools, a large number of teachers here get $100,000 a year, and that's a lot of money. As far as we are concerned, $100,000 a year is good money, one person. And if both are working, it could be much more. The amount of United States spends more than 6.5% GDP on education. Yet it ranks 35th in maths and 24th in English in the world today. I think we need to do a lot of searching on that. So when I said the right type of education, just pouring money into education by itself is not enough. It is the type of education that is imparted over there. And I mean, countries like, say, South Korea, or China, or Singapore, whose GDPs are much less than the United States, they are ranked number 1, 2, and 3 in the world. Overall, United States ranking is 23rd or 27th in the world, despite all the sophisticated technologies that we have, and all the number of teacher-taught ratios, and look at the money being spent on education over there. It is not commensurate with the results on the ground. And I think education is, school education particularly, is something which in the United States has to give a very serious review at it. Just putting in more money does not improve education. It is the type of education which you give, it is the quality of education which you give, which makes the difference. Yes, sir. The Equal Opportunity School. Well, they have now reached grade 10. So they're going to go to grade 11 after this and grade 12. And one of the reasons why I'm here today, kind courtesy of Mr. Kumar Malavalli, is to give me an opportunity at the Thai conference on the 17th to appeal to the philanthropic heart of Americans over here or Indians over here to see how they can help us in that particular area. Because that's the area we're coming to a dead end over there. What do we do after that? What do we do after that? That is a very big, something very worrying to me. What do we do after? Till then, we'll manage it. But what do we do after that? You're absolutely right. That is an area of concern.
And my second question is back to the
My question to you, sir, is that you can have all the governance in place. I can give you examples of so many countries where governance was good, where development was there, but the people felt insecure. And if 20 to 25% of a country feel insecure, and that is the population of United States of America, 25% of India's population is the population of United States of America. If 325 or 335 million people in this country are unhappy, insecure about something over there, can you wish it away? You can't. So either you're going to change or you'll be changed at the end of the day. I think India is voting for change, which is nothing wrong in that. I mean, this has not worked, let's try something. Because when people are in opposition, they say so many things, but when they come into power, they realize that it is not possible and they may change. Let's hope and pray that things do. It can't be worse than what is happening right now. So from that perspective. But purely from a leadership perspective, you cannot dismiss the hopes and aspirations of 350 million people. Yeah, if he ignored this, he's shooting himself in the foot.
Yeah.
If he's a wise man, he will do as we are discussing over there. So I think let's give him a chance. As Karl Marx said, workers of the world unite. You have nothing to lose but your chains. Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Can you expand more on what are mechanisms for building trust, either in your context but kind of more generally in the leadership context?
From a leadership concept, I think we have to first set the example. A fair number of people told me that these people won't be loyal to you. You're wasting your time. And so I said, no. I said, trust begins when you start trusting somebody. About 9 years back, I asked my personal staff to write out my shortcomings. I told them, write out my shortcomings. I asked my staff. And
was this anonymous or not anonymous?
Sir?
Was it anonymous?
Anonymous, yeah. My personal staff, about six, seven, those who work very closely with me. So to put it in simple words, they said that you trust people too much. Bordering naivety. So I said, why do you say that this is a disqualification? As a leader, can you start your leadership exercise by distrusting your people? They had no answer for that. I said, even if I know that you are not trusting, that you are being distrustful, I'll still trust you, give you a chance for it. And the chances are that most of you will come around. I think leadership cannot start without trust, number one. Number two, many people don't understand what forgiveness means. I think one of the great examples is what happened after the apartheid regime came down and the Reconciliation and Truth Commission was set up in South Africa, and that was, I think, a great thing done by Nelson Mandela. And forgiveness is defined, I would say, in greater detail in Christianity than other religions, because compassion and forgiveness are two sides of the same coin, is that you may not forget what has been done to you, but I will not do that what you have done to me. That is what forgiveness means. I mean, from your memory, it may not fade away. Our defense minister, when I was the corps commander, our defense minister, George Fernandez, had just come back from a visit to Vietnam, and he told me that he was taken to the war museum. And I was sharing this with Mr. Kumar Mallavalli this morning only at breakfast. And it showed the, you know, the atrocities done by the US Armed Forces, like Agent Orange and this and that, My Lai massacre and everything. And right at the end, there were great photographs of Bill Clinton laughing and playing with Vietnamese children and Americans, all happy. So our defense minister asked his counterpart, the Vietnamese defense minister, he says, how do you explain this? He said, life must carry on. You cannot be prisoners of the past. And therefore, the golden rule, that do unto others as you wish them to do unto you, if you reverse it the other way around over there, is that I may not forget what you have done, some bad things you've done to me, but there'll be no retribution from my side. I assure you that. I think that is a message, ma'am, you got to get across to people. And you, there are certain things possibly perceived by people that we have wronged them. There's no point in debating and discussing them. And you have to assure them that it's extremely sorry for what has happened. There's nothing I can do about it. But I can assure you one thing, that I'll see it does not happen again. Like, for example, there was a lot of problem with recruitment. Ladakh is 50% Muslim, 50% Buddhist. In the army, we have a regiment called the Ladakh Scouts, which is only for Buddhists and Muslims. There should have been 50% Muslims in the Ladakh Scout battalions. There were only 8%. So I stopped recruitment of Buddhists completely. Till such time, the Muslim enrollment came up to something like 35-38%. There was a lot of hue and cry about it from the other camp over there. But I said, no, we'll try and make up this thing over there. So wherever we can correct the wrongs of the past, I think goes a long way in building up trust over there. And I think we need to understand that we have to be more forgiving. As leaders, we have to be more forgiving in relationships. Even in human relationships, people do wrong things. They let you down at times. And I think we can't carry it all our life over there. We need to grow up a little big on this particular issue over there. Yes, sir.
Curious as to your thoughts as to kind of the necessary conditions that have to hold that would then allow parties to get to that point where they could be forgiving and they could get through their differences and actually negotiate a peace as opposed to having these conflicts go on.
Sir, to negotiate a peace, you have to be a great leader. And there's a great shortage of leaders in the world today. Look around. Can you, where are the great leaders? Can you show me where they are? Can you count on your 10 fingers, 10 people in India, 10 people in the United States of America, who will take you through the 21st century? 10 people. India is 1.2 billion or 1.2.5 billion. You are about 350, 380 billion, so we're talking about 1.5 billion. Can we count 10 people who, all of us agree, yes, they will take us through? Don't know where are they? Where have they gone? They're not available. Sorry?
Why are we not producing? Why is the world not producing these leaders? That's my same question about India, Pakistan, and what
you have to be a statesman. How many of most people are politicians, they're not statesmen? Because in this game, a lot of concessions have got to be made. And you have to be a great leader to be able to make those concessions. Who is to think largely? You have to grow out of your vested interests. Everybody looks at national interests first. My country, right and wrong. Unless and until you, in a global world particularly, unless you look at the world in a global sense over there, you are never, these conflicts are going to continue. They're going to continue. So you be matured enough to grow out of it. You have to stop thinking that you are an Indian leader or American leader. You got to think of as a world leader. Is it in world interest? If it is, yes, I'll go ahead with it. Despite the fact I may lose my presidency on that. Which very few people are prepared to do it. That's why you only got a few people in history who are there. The other thing is, a large number of people don't want to be leaders. A large number of our young people don't want to be leaders. How many of you read Atlas Shrugged by Ayn Rand? Her book, Atlas Shrugged, has sold next to the Bible. There's no other document or book in history which has sold as much as the Bible, but close to the Bible is Atlas Shrugged. She is the diva of modern individualism, or what she calls objectivism. And she says that selfishness is a virtue. The market culture and the market economy, I say yes to market economy, I say no to market culture. Milton Friedman, the guru of economy, modern economy, and that is how our thinking is shaped. He says that the business of business is business. And my loyalty, he says, is to my shareholders, and profit is the only motive. Whereas my side of the camp says that the strategic aim of business is not to make money alone, but to improve the quality of life of society. So these are the conflicting things over there. And I think Professor Sandel, in his book, which I would recommend strongly, you should all read in Harvard, What Money Cannot Buy. And the question he puts to everybody is what is it that money cannot buy? And what is it that money should not buy? I think these are certain ethical issues because of which we have this great leadership crisis today. And let me tell you, ma'am, leadership is very exacting. It draws every ounce of your blood and oxygen out of your body. And most people would rather be comfortable with their big fat bank accounts and not be leaders. Great accountability comes in over there. So I think there is a big leadership crisis in the world today. As I said, 98% of the writers of leadership today are not leaders. And they are the people who are millionaires. They've got beautiful houses over here in all over the world. So I think we are facing a big leadership crisis today in the world. There's no doubt about it. Processes. Everybody says system and process. It's man who drives the system and process. Many people believe that you don't need leaders. You need processes. But who makes the processes? I and you make the processes. We change the process. That's it.
I can't resist one last question. Can you name for me two U.S. presidents that you would qualify as great leaders?
Abraham Lincoln, definitely. His contribution to nation building, to build the country from, to take it out of civil war and restore this thing over here, I think is one of the great thing over there. I think he was a great leader over there. And rather than naming another president, which you know can be controversial, I would say Martin Luther King, one of the great leaders which your society has produced, who gave civil rights to the people. Starting from Rosa Parks' refusal to vacate her seat in the Montgomery bus over there and leading to the civil rights movement, Martin Luther King definitely would fall in the great category, in the great pantheon of leaders of the world today over there. But Abraham Lincoln, I would say, from a foundational founding father of this country, who gave the complete basis of this country, I would rate him as number one in my estimation.
George Washington, as a guy who was a servant leader and stepped away from...
Yeah, but Abraham Lincoln had greater responsibilities than George Washington. He had greater responsibilities.
Okay.
One was a military commander.
Thank you very much for coming. We're off to lunch. See you later.
Thank you very much. Thank you.